ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for coming tonight. And I would like to thank Claire and Ralph for inviting us second time. And it's a real pleasure to play here, especially for such event as Piano Duo Festival. Of course, it's very close to our heart. So we're a professional piano duo. So thank you for having us. We will start our recital with Franz Schubert, romantic Austrian composer. And we are going to play Fantasy in F minor. Many of you probably heard this piece before. It's a beautiful piece, first of all. And Schubert has many pieces for piano duet. So when two musicians play one piano for hands, it's called piano duet. When we have two pianos, it's called piano duo. So he has many, many pieces, four big volumes of piano duet music. And the music was written for amateur musicians and for professional players as well. And the reason was very simple. He was a teacher, so he needed more music to play with his students. Some students were beginners, so that's why we have pieces for amateurs and for professional players. Also, he composed many string quartets that has two violins, viola, and cello. So, also orchestral music as well. So here in that piece, you easily can hear quality of string quartet and orchestral music as well. And finally, what I would like to say about this piece, the Fantasy was his last piece. He died when he was 31 years old, so he was still young, but he was ill for a long time and he knew that he was going to die. That's probably why you're going to hear the main theme, which is a sad theme, very sad theme. Sometimes it's a very deep sorrow sometimes, and you will hear nostalgia in that theme. Some sections will bring us back to his memories about good times, young times, but still he was young when he died. So we're going to play for you Fantasy in F minor by Franz Schubert.
Thank you. So now we're going to switch to completely different character, completely different composer, and completely different influence. So Darius Milhaud was a French composer in the 1920s, 1930s. But as the life in Paris, like in the light of Great Depression, became very difficult and kind of depressing for him as well, he decided to take a civil job and became a secretary of a French embassy in Brasilia. And he thought it's going to be a short stint just to make a little money and come back, but he liked the title too much. So he stayed there for at least 3 years. And he had the time of his life. He had went clubbing, attend bars, was greatly inspired by Latin American dances and sounds. And obviously he needed to make some money, so he wrote music for plays, and he was very prolific. So if you look at his catalog of his works, those are hundreds and hundreds of opus numbers, and sometimes it's the same thing, just reprinted in a different key. So in 1937, he was running a little short of money, and he got a call from famous French pianist Marguerite Long, who wanted him to compose a suite for two pianos. He was obviously short on time after all that clubbing, so he decided to reuse some of the music he composed earlier for some accidental theatrical plays. So that's how Suite Scaramouche came to life. There are three movements. First two have more like an abstract title, so first one is like fast, like lively. Second one is contrasting, is moderate, kind of slower. And the third one is Brasileiro. It has clear influence of Brazilian famous dance samba. So there are samba movements. Now, believe it or not, sometimes accidental walk becomes one of the most famous. And that's the story of Scaramouche. So it became so popular that after it was premiered for two pianos, Milhaud got commissions to transpose it to different instruments and even a chamber orchestra. So we're going to play Suite for two pianos, Scaramouche by Darius Milhaud. Thank you. We are going to continue the second half of the program with piece by German composer Max Reger. And usually when I ask how many of you have heard about Max Reger, occasionally a few hands go up, but not so many. And if you haven't heard his name, you're in a good company. Many, many people haven't heard his name. So he's a German late romantic composer from 1870s, 80s, and 90s. He became famous as an organ player, and he is actually was composer. He's German, but he's from Munich. If you have ever visited Munich, you know it was imperial capital of Bavaria. So the streets are white, the buildings are grand, so it's supposed to impress. So is Max Reger's music. So usually if you go, he wrote quite a few symphonies. So if you go to a symphony concert, open the program and see that there is a Max Reger's symphony on the program, you can safely say it's a 45 plus minutes of music. When, I don't want to scare you, the piece we're going to play is quite brief. So what is interesting though, when you see a master who specializes in writing those big monumental symphonies, attempts to write something miniature, you get something like the piece we're going to play right now, Six Burlesques, Opus 57. So what's I feel cool about those pieces, each one is very brief. It's like between 2 to 3 minutes. But each one has so much music material that some other composer would write a whole symphony just by using those two brief minutes of music. And that's what makes it funny when you're trying to squeeze so much important and different and contrasting content into brief 3 minutes of music. So Six Burlesques, this is original composition for one piano, four hands. Six Burlesques by Max Reger.
Thank you.
And now from composer who tried to squeeze all of his ideas into those 2-3 minutes, I mean, you can appreciate how much work it is, right? We're going to play one of our favorite pieces, Rachmaninoff First Suite for two pianos. This is early Rachmaninoff, so it's Opus 5, and he wrote it yet as a student and dedicated to Tchaikovsky. Why I'm saying it's an early piece, because it's still in this period of time when Rachmaninoff already have found his famous nostalgic harmonies, but he's still very much in love with impressionistic music. That's why each movement of that suite has a title that is supposed to spike imagination, right? So the first one is a barcarolle. It's Italian song, and Rachmaninoff wrote after this one, this is his first one, quite a few barcarolles. What is cool for me, most of the barcarolles I know are in G minor, and this is no exception. So there is something special in that color. And then the second movement, depending on the translation, it's a night of love or a night for love. So again, he's trying to portray, I think, night garden, with a little nachtigall, bird singing in the distance, and it's all about love. And then the third moment is tears. And Rachmaninoff is famous for having those continuous motifs coming, like, you know, just reciting it. So that has a four notes motif that he's going to expand into that grand tear movement. And then the last moment, Rachmaninoff was a very devoted Russian Orthodox Christian. And the last month is called Easter. If you ever attended Easter, or watched on YouTube, Russian Orthodox Easter church service, you will see that they have a lot of singing, but they also, they don't use organ, but they use a lot of bells, different type of bells. It's not like the hand bells that are popular in the United States, but it's still, each bell has its own voice. So this movement is called Easter, but what you're going to hear, it's continuous bell sound. Each moment, why I'm saying that Rachmaninoff was still very much into his impressionistic period, because each movement is prefaced by a famous poetry that you're supposed to read, get inspired, and then there is a representation in music. So, First Suite by Sergei Rachmaninoff.